And our today's expert is the director of the Regional Center for Energy Policy Research in Hungary, Dr. Laszlo Szabó. And I'm glad to have also one of the most prominent Armenian experts, Astmine Pasoyan, joining us for today's meeting. And she will summarize the outcomes of this module of our program, and we will publish a paper on renewable energy sector development and the possibilities for Armenia specifically. And now I would like to invite Dr. Szabó to start the presentation.
First of all, thank you very much for the invitation. So thanks a lot for inviting me for this workshop. And what my plan is actually is that I will do a half an hour, 40 minute presentation actually, which will cover two areas. I will have a look at the feed-in tariff schemes and premium schemes and auctioning schemes in general, because I would like to give an overview who these various renewable schemes work in practice. And then I will turn my presentation to the Hungarian experiences. And I will keep it short because I think 30 minutes should be all right for that, because I'm here to answer your question if you have any, because actually I have to admit that I received quite a lot of information, but actually I don't know what was covered in the previous presentation, so I don't want to duplicate the things. So just please let me know if you already heard about these things or you learned about that. And I will be a bit quicker on those parts.
No, that would be new for us.
Okay, and actually from this, you already learned that what I will do, I will mainly focus on the power sector, and I will focus on the possible support systems. And then with this, I will start sharing my presentation. Just a second. And I try to do it in a bigger size. Do you see this now?
Yes.
Is it okay? Or shall I make it? Can I make it bigger or it's full screen?
It seems fine.
Okay.
It's full screen already.
Okay. So what I gave as a title, this is Renewable Support Schemes, and I will talk about the case of Hungary, which is, I think, quite a good case, because what we do actually is that we are moving our renewable support scheme from the feed-in tariff system to a more advanced auction scheme. And this is what I would like to cover in my presentation. So actually what I will do six items. I will give a brief overview on the various instruments. Who do you support usually your renewables in your system? Then we have a look at how it is evolved over the past 10 years in Europe. Then I will turn to the auctioning system, because that's quite an interesting one, and quite many countries already apply it. And we have to know that this is not only European countries, so not only European member states, but quite a lot of other countries worldwide apply this design as well. And then I will turn to the Hungarian situation, in the Hungarian case. So that's what I will plan to do in this half an hour. And then actually, I start with this usual slide that when you have your target, because that's the first thing which you have to determine, that in your country, if you want to have certain amount of renewables, usually the ministry or the government is setting long-term target for you, and it's setting the target not only for the power sector, but it is setting for an overall renewable target, and then you are putting it or streaming it down to certain sectors. And then what you do is usually you have targets for your power sector, for your heating sector, for your transport, and so on and so on. And if you end up, then you will reach your target over a 10-year period or even over a longer time period. So that's the usual way we do it in Europe. And we see that quite many countries around Europe and outside Europe follows this type. What do you, and I told you that I will focus on the power sector, so electricity generation. What do you support there, the generation, the renewable generation. It's not only the feed-in tariff scheme, because that's the first thing which comes to your mind, but there are many other schemes which is available. So you can do this support through administering pricing instruments. You can do this net metering schemes, for example. It is applied in quite many European countries as well, amongst them in Hungary. So you can provide them certainty that you net meter the production and the consumption in certain household or at small enterprises, and then you are just paying the net of this bill. So that's a quite interesting scheme with quite a lot of pro and contra argument for this. And then you can use other financial instruments, like you can support the investment cost and so on and so on. But what we have to see is that many countries are decided not to go for this other type of scheme, but what they do is that they actually give production-based support. And the first of these were the feed-in tariffs. And I just give you the details here. And that's what you see on the graph now, is that what is a feed-in tariff scheme actually in a power system? A feed-in tariff scheme means that you are facilitating the renewables, which are more expensive than the average wholesale electricity price. You are promoting them with a certain amount of support. But actually what you do is that you are not differentiating the support part and the electricity wholesale part of the electricity, but what you do is that you are promising a regulated tariff for the producers. So actually you are setting the tariff. Let's say you are setting it at 8 eurocents per kilowatt hour, and those who will be eligible in the scheme, they will receive this 8 eurocents per kilowatt hour for every kilowatt hour which they produce. It's a quite interesting scheme, quite nice. It was widely applied in Europe and in other countries, because in one hand, this is reducing the risk of the investors in that system. So those who are under the scheme, they can calculate with a very reliable cash flow in their system, which means that it's a very attractive scheme if the tariff is set at the competitive level. So if the tariff is set at an attractive level, it would mean that it will generate investment in renewables. That's what we saw actually in quite many countries. What you have to see at the same time is that you are not only promising a reliable cash flow for the developer, but at the same time, and that's where the name coming, feed-in tariff, is that you have a takeover obligation from either the TSO or from any other obliged party part, which means that it's anytime a producer is producing this renewable electricity, he doesn't have to sell it on any market participants, if you have a market, because that's the first question, but it will be paid out from a central budget. And there is no right to cut the production, only in cases of an emergency. So it has a priority dispatch as well. It will come first in the merit order, and then if you have to switch off other generators, it will not be them, but for example, gas-based generation or coal-based generation will have shrinking market type of situation. That's the theory of the feed-in tariff. If you go to another type of scheme, which is a more market friendly, what I would say is this is a feed-in premium type of scheme. What is the difference between a feed-in tariff and a feed-in premium? The difference is that you are only promising the producer this extra payment, which means that you are promising this extra payment over the market price. If you have this market price, it sometimes can be a wholesale price which is determined by the regulator. But what you do in this system is that you are asking the renewable producer to market its product, to sell it to a buyer, and then once he was able to sell the electricity, he will receive this additional payment. And what is important here is that there is no takeover obligation. What it means that you really have to find a buyer in your country for this product. And once this taken place, then you will receive this extra subsidy. What you have to see is that many countries in Europe moved away from the feed-in tariff scheme to this type of scheme, because it is more market-oriented than the feed-in tariff scheme. If you want to show it in a nice graph, what you can observe here is that I show you the different schemes in a more visual way, because what you can see here is what happens in the feed-in tariff case. In the feed-in tariff case, because you were setting the tariff in advance and you are setting it for a long time, usually it's 15, 20 years. You set it for a long time and independently how the market price, the wholesale price will evolve in your country, they will receive this fixed payment. Very reliable scheme for the investor. Usually you see that quite a lot of payment you have to pay when the market prices, for example, they go down. If the market price is above, it's quite an interesting situation because they would still receive a smaller amount of money. What do we see that, what is the difference in the premium case? There are two types of the premium. The first type is when you are promising this extra top-up payment as a fixed amount. So for example, you are promising 2 euro cents per kilowatt hour extra payment for the producers. It means your production and your prices and income will follow the market volatility. So you have a volatile income, which makes a bit more risky your investment. So investors would be a bit more afraid of this type of scheme, the fixed premium scheme. However, there is a solution that, and this is the so-called sliding feed-in premium. When you are actually promising this top-up, but this pop-up, the top-up money is flexible in that way that if the market price is going down, you are receiving higher amount. If the market price is smaller, then you will receive smaller amount. And actually, if the market price is high enough, you can even receive higher payments for your renewable production. However, there is a question mark here because there are two solutions. Sometimes you leave it there, this money. Sometimes you take away from the renewable producers, which is, again, an interesting question. And why did we move? That's the big question. Why most European countries moved away from the feed-in tariff scheme, and we are at the feed-in premium case, and then usually this feed-in premium is auctioned in the system. And I brought this chart from the IRENA, and then the nice answer here is that we are moving away from the feed-in tariff scheme because there are very strong learning effects in certain technologies, mainly in the photovoltaic technology. And when you can learn not similar, but some learning effect in the wind-based generation as well. What does this mean? We see that through this technological learning and learning by doing, that the cost of investment was very sharply decreasing in these two technologies. And that's a problem for the regulators. Usually when you had the feed-in tariff schemes, regulators had to set this tariff for 1 or 2 years time. And then you can imagine that in the case when this cost curve is very steeply decreasing, then it's very difficult to follow this curve because it might mean that you have to change your tariff every quarter of a year. And it's very difficult, it's very challenging for the administration. And then if you are not able to do that, then there is a problem because if you are fixing your feed-in tariff, for example, for 2 years time, and the costs are reducing very significantly, it would mean that you are paying an extra payment for the producers, which would mean that you are increasing the tariff for the end users, and you don't like it. I mean, you have quite a lot of critic. We had actually in Europe that in many cases, this happened like in the case of Czech Republic, Romania, or in Spain. And then they actually, it's true that they made some extra payment for these producers. And that was the main reason we were moving away from the feed-in tariff scheme. There is a second reason why you move away from this, that it's not really following the market and it's not really competitive. If you are applying the premium system, it is more following the market trends. It's more following your electricity system. And it's very easily, and flexible enough with premium schemes to turn them into an auction scheme. And I will elaborate a bit later on this one. Just to show you again on a nice graph, which I was taking from the International Energy Agency, what is the problem with the feed-in tariff scheme? And then you can see the example of two countries, Italy and Germany. And you see the small and the large size, commercial size capacity. There, where in both countries for a while it was a feed-in tariff. What happened, and I just elaborate on the German case for the commercial size installation, you can see here that they made most type of errors. So once you are overcharging, I mean, once you are paying more for these companies here, then it would mean that there is a very high uptake. That's what you see here. When it was overcharged, there were a lot of photovoltaic generation coming into the German system. You can see that here, you can see the number that gigawatts of capacity were coming in. And then it is very difficult to plan with this. So with the feed-in tariff scheme, if you are putting the tariff level too high, then lots of generation will come in. If you have another example like Italy, you are setting the tariff level too low. It will be not attractive for your investors, and then you see zero investment here. You can imagine that with the feed-in tariff scheme, if you are not setting the tariff right, you can make both errors. You want to reach your target, you set the tariff, no one would come to your country. It's not a pleasant situation. The other situation is not a pleasant one because it might generate extra payments for the consumers. And I see that there is a question from
Yeah, I apologize. I'm not sure I'm reading the graphs right because I don't see the okay. any labels, the red, the green, the yellow okay. bars. Could you explain what's what so yes, that I'm sure I'm reading yeah. it right?
So what the graph shows here actually is that what was the, it was a backward calculation, what was the cost level of the photovoltaic generation in the given technology. It is the red stripes give you that range that where the regulator should have taken the tariff. There is a range because you cannot tell it precisely. So in the case, just to give you an example here, but in this case, in the German example, the tariff for this photovoltaic generation should have been between this range. So between, let me see, this is somewhere between 40 and 60 euro per megawatt hour. But what happened actually is that the tariff was set higher. And then with this, it was triggering. You can imagine that this tariff at the beginning was very, very high level. It was at the top of this stripe. And it meant that lots of investors were coming into the system. That's why there is this very steep investment in the system. Look at this different situation when Italy was determining this tariff level at a low level. So it's below the optimal level. No one. Here you can see no one came into the system. Only when this system reached the optimal level, investors started to come. The problem was in this type of system actually, is that it was very difficult to follow the market development. And I'm just jumping back to my previous slide because you can imagine if the technology cost is that steeply decreasing as what you can observe here for the photovoltaic technology. And you can see here yours. So for example, if you have determined your feed-in tariff level at this 0.3 US dollar cents per kilowatt hour, sorry, it's 0.3 US dollar, not cents, 0.3 US dollar per kilowatt hour, and then you set this tariff for 2 years, you can imagine those guys who were coming 2 years later, they were generating extra profits for them. So actually in this case, what happened is that many regulators started to set this tariff on an annual level, and even sometimes in Germany happened every quarter of the level. If you are a regulator, it's a very difficult job. You don't really like it. And it's just to give you another example, the Czech Republic in 2010, they were determining this amount at the 2010 prices. And actually they were setting the tariff in a low, which was very difficult to change. So it took them 1.5 year to change the tariff level. And in these 2 years, 2 gigawatts of capacity came into the system at a very high price level. This is not a fair system. And that's why many countries and the DG competition, the Directorate General to the European Commission Competition Authority said as well that please, if you can do that, then please avoid this feed-in tariff scheme in the future, because this was a very nice tool actually at the beginning of the renewable support period. It was nicely working because generators, developers were coming into the system, but later on, when the system changed, it was too expensive system for the countries. And then many countries in the European system changed due to this reason, these two reasons, difficult to determine the right tariff. The second issue, we saw many countries which had bad experience with overpayments. What we can see in the next graph, which I brought from REN 21, is that there is a nice study which is showing you how it is evolved in the past. How many countries apply the feed-in tariff scheme, and that's what you see in the gray chart, and how many countries are applying tendering schemes mainly based on premium system. And then you can see that still many countries apply feed-in tariff scheme. So many newcomers, and that's a very clear message. Newcomer country, which is just at the very beginning of this process to have targets and they want to achieve these renewable shares, usually you will start with a feed-in tariff scheme because that's the way you can give certainty to investors. And in most of the European countries, those are started. But once you are starting to elaborate your system, you start to have the higher deployment of renewables, then you might turn to this auctioned premium system. And then we see the numbers are really expanding in this arena. And then why I brought this second graph from the study itself, that what you have to see is that what I mentioned to you is not a European invention. It's true that in Europe, you have quite a high share of auctioned technologies and renewable generation. But you can see that in other countries like Southeast Asia, the Americas, the Central and Western Asia, and Africa, they also apply. So it's not true that the auction system can only be applied in developed market. You can auction your renewable generation in a less developed market as well. And then there are good examples for that. And then you can have quite a nice deployment of renewables. Because what you expect from turning to from a feed-in tariff scheme, from an auctioned premium scheme, is that you have some nice outcomes. What are these nice outcomes? I think the two or three most important parts. The first one is that in this case, the price determination is based on the auction. So if you are doing a nice auction scheme and there are quite many competitors, then the competition itself will determine the price level where they will come to your system. So it's not anymore on the shoulders of the regulator or the ministry to determine whether it's 10 cents or 8 cents which I should give to the producers, but it will be the competition, the market, the auction, which will determine this level. And the second issue, what we see in Europe and from other countries' experience as well, that by setting the auctions, you are setting a quantity-based target, so you don't have this overshooting effect. So once you are making an auction, for example, for 200 megawatts of photovoltaic, then you achieve two objectives. The first objective is that if it's really competitive, there are quite many applicants for your auction. It would mean that you will receive competitive price. Second, there is no overshooting because you are only giving the license for 200 megawatts, not for more. In spite of the fact that there are maybe 400, 500, 600 megawatts of application, you are giving the license to the best. And the best means in this case cheapest, which means that you are reducing the cost for the consumers. And actually, this is your target. You want to have renewable in your system at a certain target level, but what you have at the same time, you want to have it at the lowest cost possible. And this is the promise of the auction, and this is the good news. The bad news is this, is that once you are setting up an auction scheme, you have to deal with 20, 30 different parameters. And because I think I use my time quite heavily, I don't elaborate on all of them, I just underline two or three issues from this, and then if you are interested, we can come back to this later. So actually, of course, it's very, very complex system. Once you are setting up an auction, you have to determine that what type of technologies you would like to see in the system, what type of mechanism you want to use to select the winners. Is it only the price, the bidding price, which matters, or you want to include other characteristics? The second thing, you want to have a specific site for the auction, or you want to open the whole country, and then they can determine that which are the best position for the various countries, what is the extension, so how many years you want to give the support actually for them, whether you are using this premium type of scheme. Actually, it's free, you can use the feed-in tariff scheme together with the auction scheme, but we see less of an experience there. And the second issue is that who do you ensure that those who are winning the auctions, they will realize the project within 2 or 3 years time? And that's a big question here, because that's a difficult design element in the auctions, because somehow what you would like to do is that you want to really make the auctioners to really realize these projects actually within 2 or 3 years time. And it's sometimes quite difficult to pressure them that they will do that. And actually the way it is done in most of the countries is that you are actually putting some penalties on them. And at the same time, you are asking for bid bonds and realization bond for them. What does that mean? Once you are winning the auction, actually before participating for the auction, you might ask some money for them. In order to make the bidding very serious. So because if you are asking 1 or 2, usually it's in a range of €4 per megawatt, which is auctioned, kilowatt of auction capacity. Once they have to make these bids and they have to pay into a certain budget line, then they will be more pressured to make their bid viable. And then once they are bidding in and they are winning the auctions, you have to make this bid level, security level a bit higher. Because if they have to pay in advance, for example, 2, 3, or 4% of their investment value, and they have to put aside a specific bank account, for example, of the regulator, you are really pushed toward realizing the process. And that's an important step, because it's not only that you want to have good prices at the auctions, but what you would like to see is that you want to see these auction capacities realized. If you want to have some good examples in that, in the German photovoltaic auction, the realization rate is somewhere 99-98%. You can see other countries and other technologies where this realization rate is something like 60 or 70%, which is not a good news, because it would mean that some 20-30% of the winners, they just said that no, this project is not viable anymore. There were things happening in your market, so I'm withdrawing from realizing the project. But you can see there are at least 10 different aspects of setting the auctions right, and then you have to deal quite well with these aspects. So if you are doing it first time, you might need some advice for how to do a best auction design. My last slide on this European part is that, okay, how the auctions actually work in Europe. And what I brought actually is a nice presentation from a project. It's called Aures. And if you have time and then you are interested in, you can go to the website of this project, because there are quite a lot of useful examples and case studies on the renewable auctions. And then I just drew this graph from one of the studies, which was showing that how the prices evolved over this 8 years, actually 7 years in Europe in various countries. And then we can see some good trends in it. We see some decreasing prices. So from a 20 euro cents per kilowatt hour, which was in 2012 in this country, the blue one is the French auction, and the Dutch auction was at this range in 2014 as well. We saw a quite nice price reduction trend over 2019. So even 50% reduction. So actually the message here is that auctions were quite good in following this cost reduction trends over Europe. And even newcomer countries, because Hungary just started auctioning in the last 2 years, we were managing to have prices at a very, very low level. And then you can see that countries like Portugal and Spain, they reach prices which is in the 3 euro cents per kilowatt hour, or even the latest Spanish one is 2.5 euro cents per kilowatt hour. Auction level. So this was really a big achievement in the European auction, that the prices were really follow the price trends. And with this, I have only two or three slides to show on Hungary, because I would like to show that what is happening in my country, because it can be a good example, for example, for Armenia, because I had a look, we had quite a similar picture in the electricity generation sector at least. I will tell you why I think it's quite in a similar shoe as in Armenia. What you can observe here is that we don't have too high percentage of renewable in our system. Originally, it was something like 7% in 2005. Our target actually at that time, which we were setting, was 13%. So we wanted to more than double the renewable share in the total system. So it's not only electricity generation, but the whole system. And actually, we were on a very good path. Up to 2014, we were increasing our renewable share even to 16%. And then a very interesting thing happened, because now we are a bit below our target value. And it's a good question whether in the exact year of 2020, whether we reach the target or we are a bit below that one. And it's a very interesting question why this happened. And you can see here three sectors. The first one is the heating sector. Then the blue one is the power sector and the transport sector. So if you sum up these three, that would generate the average value here. Why do we have this reduction in the renewable generation? The answer is it's not in the power sector and it's not in the transport sector, because there the numbers are always increasing. We are having more and more renewable generation. But what happened that in your heating market, the share of biomass is reducing. Actually, I just turned to my next slide where you can see the Hungarian situation, that around half of the renewable which is used in the heating sector is solid biomass. It's conventional burning of biomass in households, so we are burning it for heating. And actually what happened in this tendency is that the gas price were reduced in these 4 or 5 years, what you can see here. And actually the heating system in the household sector was changing from the biomass to the gas-based heating system. And that was the main reason why our numbers are deteriorating. In the other sectors, in the electricity and in the transport sector, we are increasing the share. Actually, I was showing the wrong figure, because the heating is here and it's not only 50%, but it's 67 or even 70% of the renewable heating was coming from biomass. So it's not 50, because that chart is for the renewable power sector slide. Sorry for that. And just the last slide on the Hungarian situation, actually is this, and that's why I said it's quite a good example for your country, because as far as I know, you have very similar mix actually. So if you have a look at this 2017 picture, if you are looking at it, we have a quite wide range of portfolio. We have nuclear generation here, we have gas-based generation as well, which is the blue part here. So orange is the nuclear, blue is the gas-based generation. We have still some coal, and we have a very tiny amount of renewable, because we don't have hydro. So in that sense, we are not similar. We have much more hydro than we have in the system. And we have very little amount of photovoltaic and wind-based generation in 2017. Actually, if you come to the picture, in the next picture, this is already quite close to the present situation, although it's 2025. But in 2021, we are already very close to this picture, because what we are doing actually in Hungary is that we are getting really higher and higher share of photovoltaic generation in our system. The gas-fired generation is reducing, and actually the coal-fired generation will be out of the system in 2025, actually. So in 4 years' time, we will finish producing electricity from coal. And then what you can see here, and these are the official governmental plans, so these are not NGOs, this is the official Hungarian government plan, actually, which we handled into the European Union, is that by 2030, actually what we are targeting is that we are getting a system where we will have 6,000 megawatts, so 6 gigawatts of photovoltaic in the system. And by 2040, it will be something like over 10 gigawatts of photovoltaic in the system. So we have very ambitious plans, and these are started to be realized, because actually what happened that in 2017, and I show you in the next slide, in 2017, we hardly had 100 megawatts of photovoltaic. And what we can see, and up till 2021, these are real figures. So these are the hardcore data from the Hungarian electricity system. We had in the last year 1,700 megawatts of photovoltaic. This year we are already over, I think last month we took over 2,000 megawatts. Now you see the penetration will be evolve in the future up till 2030 actually. What you can observe here that there are three types of generation which comes in for photovoltaic. The first one is the household size. So this is the red one. And this is what is shown, that it is quite an important part now. Quite a lot of households are using photovoltaic generation based on actually this net metering scheme, which will be finished in 2 years' time. That's why we don't see further growth here. What we can observe that the feed-in tariff scheme, the light gray one, had this very sizable impact. And for 2 years more, it will be still increasing because there are already licenses given out for the feed-in tariff scheme. And the rest, what you can see here, will come through the tendering procedure. So by 2030, almost one third will be auctioned, a bit more than one third will be a feed-in tariff, and maybe less than a quarter will be household size photovoltaic. And we're really targeting, and it seems that we'll go for the 6,600 megawatts of capacity. And you can imagine, just to put into perspective, or peak load actually is around this number, 7,000 megawatts was the last year peak consumption. So you can imagine we'll have some important challenges to keep the system balances in such a system, because it can cause quite a lot of up and downward generation in our system. And this is my last slide, because I promise that I will show you some results of the auction scheme in Hungary, which we had already 2 rounds, so in 2020 and just last month we had the second round, and we had very, very good experiences. Just to show you that what was the cost reduction, in 2019, so just 2 years ago, the feed-in tariff level, which was determined by the regulator, was at 10 euro cents per kilowatt hour, so 2 years ago. Then we had the first year auction in 2020, and already at that time, you can see that we reached prices, and I show you here, this is the 6.8 cents. So already 1 year later, in the first auction scheme, we reached 30% reduction. And if you have a look at the second auction, which is here, and then if you have a look at the prices, the average price here was 4.7 euro cents per kilowatt hour, which means that only within 2 years' time, the 10 euro cents tariff level is reduced for 4.7. So it's less than half now. And these are winning auctions. Some 20 players in the auction won this prize, and they have now 3 years actually to realize the project. And maybe a few more messages, because it's not only the price which is interesting, but maybe two or three more issues here. The Hungarian auction was a so-called technology neutral or multi-technology auction, because we were not limiting the auction to photovoltaic. Other technologies except wind, because the wind is not allowed in Hungary in these recent years. Other technologies like biomass, geothermal, they could have come for the auction. And some bids were there, but actually what we observed is that it was only the photovoltaic technology. So in this sense, photovoltaic seems to be really the winner of this technology portfolio, because they seem to be the cheapest one, at least in our country, in Hungary. I can imagine that in Armenia, you have quite a lot of sunny hours in your year. So you might have this photovoltaic technology as a winning technology. In Hungary, we are not very well with the wind-based generation. We don't have strong sites for the wind-based generation. We have something like 300 megawatts installed in the system, and actually the government is keeping quite a strong distance rules, which means that we probably will not have any new wind-based generation in the coming 2 or 3 years. We'll have a look at later what happens. So actually, if you are considering this price level, which was achieved already in Hungary, it's a good question whether in your country, what is your expectation, what is your target actually for this renewable generation, because actually already in this auction we reached well below wholesale electricity price in this auction, because what we see that in Hungary now the wholesale electricity price is somewhere between 5 to 6 euro cents, and what you can see it's already below that. So actually it is getting quite price competitive with the other generation. You saw it that it's probably not competitive still, not with the nuclear, but with the gas-based generation it's competitive, because we have quite a high-priced imported gas actually in our country. It's coming from Russia, but you can imagine that all this transmission cost and other cost element is coming on top of it. So it's quite a pricey resource. We have to pay something like between 50 to 60 euro per megawatt hour for the gas-based generator. And compared to that one, photovoltaic, whenever they can produce electricity, this seems to be quite competitive already. And with this, I would like to thank for your attention. And sorry for I was a bit longer than I planned for, but I hoped I showed you some interesting slide at least, and I'm really here for you, open for any question which you might have concerning the presentation. Thanks for your patience.
Yeah, thank you very much, Laszlo, for the presentation. And if there are questions or comments, I would like to invite you.
Sorry, I had a bit of noise and I see already the question coming. Please go ahead.
Hi. Well, first of all, thank you very much for the presentation. Very interesting. And I think the experience of Hungary is very applicable to Armenia, especially because our renewable energy promotional policy started a few years later, so we're behind in the schedule, which may give us an opportunity to learn from some of the transitions Hungary has made. I have tons of questions, and I probably, you know, can't ask them all in the time limits we have. But several of them are, first of all, we only have the net metering and the feed-in tariff, and then for larger plants we have auctions. Anything beyond 5 megawatt in Armenia. And with this respect, I have questions to net metering. That's my first question. You mentioned that there's only 2 years left. So I'm curious as to what is the exit strategy of the government once this net metering is terminated, all the surplus electricity that remains in the grid, what is it going to be sold at? My second question, I was curious about the feed-in premium. And if you'd be able to talk about it a little more, I was wondering whether, you know, if I hear more about it, if it's applicable to Armenia, because I do realize that these feed-in tariffs eventually become a burden, you know, with the long-term power purchase agreements. And again, whether these feed-in premiums may have a compromise. Also these, you know, the auctions, you mentioned.
Hello, guys.
Yes. Hi, Arta. So the question, my last question about auctions, does the state identify the locations and auction them out to the most interested bidder with the lowest bid, or whether they come with their own project with their own location? So that's kind of, you know, how does the auction work basically in terms of site identification? Thank you.
Thank you very much for the question. I mean, these are all, the three of them are very, very interesting. And I will try to go in order to ask them. And then you first asked on this net metering scheme. And then Hungary is one of the best example who to design a very attractive net metering scheme, but with quite a lot of KV. And then just to explain, because there are quite many different net metering scheme, and we were actually in Hungary, we were applying the original form of it. So for household and small enterprises, so it was not only household, but some enterprises below a certain level, and even schools and hospitals were allowed to do that. They had a very simple, let's say, net metering scheme, because what happened there is that there was only one metering point at this site, which meant that actually what they measured, it was a bidirectional meter, so it was actually measuring either within a quarter of a year or within one year, what was the consumption of the given household, and what was the production which was injected into the network. And if they decided to go for example, for a yearly net metering, it happened that, okay, the meter was read only once a year, and then they had a look at the saldo of it. And if it was zero, it meant a zero payment. If it was some injection into the network, there was a small payment, some 2-3 euros for the owners. And if it was a negative one, you consume more, you had to pay for the consumption of. But actually, because you had the information, what is usual consumption before, usually these systems were designed in that way that on a yearly step, it was very close to zero. And then all the people who participated in this were very happy, because actually what it meant that at the end of the year, they received a nice check with a 0 cents to be paid. And that's nice at the beginning of the system, because we had this quite significant uptake of household net metered based generation. But actually, if you consider this, it's not the best solution if you have a few hundred megawatts. So why do I say that? I say that because what you realize is that these people, they do not really pay for the using of the network, in spite of the fact they are injecting electricity into the network. They are taking electricity from the network during the night hours or in the winter time. They don't pay any cents for that one. So my message here is that it's a nice system. It would attract investors because it becomes competitive, but still you might want them to pay for the network usage. So some part of the cost, and this is not the energy part, but the network charges, you might want them to pay as well. And if you have that payment, I think it's a nice system. We don't have it in Hungary, and we have finished the system because of this partly. And the second issue here is that European Union is telling that such a system which we apply in Europe should finish in 2 years' time. And we are already considering how to change the system, not to finish it very, very suddenly and very sharply. Actually, there is no clear strategy on that. The ministry is working on that. My impression is that those who are already in the system, they will enjoy this net metering for quite many years more. The question is that who can you set up that, okay, it is still open for 10 years for them, or you start to introduce this payment. I think that's what the ministry is thinking about. If you have a different type of net metering, what I mentioned, that you signal for the user that they have to pay still for the network use, I think that's a much better system. And if you have such a system in Armenia, that I think you can operate for a longer term, because in that sense, for the energy, I wouldn't like them to pay for, because they generate their own electricity, in spite of the fact that it's still true that you are using the system as a battery, and then you are still injecting and consuming electricity. So you might consider this, that maybe some payments will be needed. My answer here would be that it's an ongoing process in Hungary. You just consider various alternatives, that what is the direction to go for. And amongst them, probably this will be the strategy that, of course, those who invested into this system, and actually in Hungary, we did not tell them any exact angle of the system. So once you install it, they can understand the system that it's there forever. So there was no such a system which told them that, okay, it's only for 15 years. So they have to introduce this end period as well, which can be quite difficult. The second question was on the premium. So that's an interesting question. my impression, what I learned from Armenia, is that you are only at that stage that you are starting to elaborate the framework to introduce the wholesale electricity market. So it's not there yet. And that's a clear message, because premium schemes work well if you have already a market-based wholesale price. And if you are there within 2-3 years' time, that can be a very interesting system, because the real difference between the premium schemes and the feed-in tariff scheme, actually, if you are going for the, let me go back to this slide, if you go for the flexible scheme, the sliding feed-in premium, if you are going for this third type, which you see on the right-hand side of the graph, so if you go for this type of scheme, it means it's very, very similar to the feed-in tariff scheme, because what happens here? You are promising them a certain payment at a certain level. Just let me give you an example, 8 euro cents per megawatt hour. And if you are already in that stage that you have a wholesale market price, then what you do actually is that the wholesale market price is 6 euro cents per kilowatt hour, you have to pay this 2 euros. If the market price is actually going up to 8, then you don't pay anything. If it goes down again, you still start to pay this extra payment. And it's a very interesting question, what happens, and it happens many times in Hungary, if the price is above your strike price, the promised price level, then there are two possibilities. Either the generator can take it and it's his own money, or in many countries already in Europe, you ask them to pay it back. So imagine a situation when it goes up to 10 euro cents, the strike level, strike price level is 8 euro cents, you can ask the renewable generator to pay this money back. Very nice situation, because that's you can already tell the consumers, look, these companies are already paying back money. The main difference between the two schemes, the feed-in and the sliding feed-in, that they are on the market. So they will realize there is a price difference in the low price period and the high price period. And in that way, because you have to sell your product, you will be really taking care of what is the market and who it is going on and who it is evolving. Actually, if you have the auction scheme, it's a very good question. But in this type of situation, it's very interesting, because they might have to have a good picture that what will be the price level evolvement in the future in your country, which will be a very difficult situation in your country, because if you are just starting the market, it's very difficult to have a good sense that what will be the future the wholesale electricity price in your country. In Hungary and other European countries, because we have a history, there are good estimations to the wholesale electricity price will look like in the next 2 or 5 years. The problem comes that we are not only talking about 2 years, but what we are talking about is 10 years or 15 years period. So that's a difficult issue to have to deal with. So that's about the premium issue. And the third issue was on auctioning, and the question was on the location. It's a very good and very interesting question, whether in the auctions, do you determine the slots, the areas, the geographical areas where you would like to see the, for example, if it's a photovoltaic plant, you would like to have it here. And what we can see that there are quite diverse experience in it, even in Europe. So we see auctions where this determination is there. So the regulator or the responsible party who's responsible for the auction is determining that where they would like to see these developments. That's a good example. I think it's Portugal who did that. Outside the European Union, it was Albania who actually did that type of auction. And that's a very interesting case. I see in Europe, these are the two cases, but if we look a bit further outside Europe, I think you would see further examples here. Some Middle East countries did similar things as well. What are the advantages and disadvantages? What is the pro and contra for that? Because there are quite many pros and quite many contras for such a system. And let me start with the pro argument. The pro argument is that once you determine the site, actually you are determining the connection points as well. With that one, actually you are taking away some of the burdens from the developers, because no exactly that what is the nearest connection point, and they can be sure that there is a connection there. And by that, you can reduce the burden of the planning of the system, because you know, okay, this is the connection point, this is the cable which I need for them, and I know the site, so I know that, okay, this site will be used. Actually, there is the difference between the Albanian and the Portuguese case, because in Portugal, actually, they designated the connection point, but they didn't tell that what will be the location of the site. So actually, it was on the shoulder of the developer who had to find this certain area. But in case of the Albanian option, they had a quite nice price achieved. The government was giving that. So it was not only the connection point, but the land was provided for the option. And in that sense, it's an additional cost reduction for the price, because then the auctioneer can be sure that, okay, I even have the location. In the case of the Portuguese auction, it was still a bit uncertain that, okay, what type of land I can buy around the connection point. And you can imagine that there was this negative effect that once the government was stating that, okay, this will be the area because this is the connection point, many of the landowners started to price in this type of, so that is difficult to avoid, of course. In most of the European auction, however, what you can see is that there was no such a land determination. So in most of them, they said that it's the developer who has to decide that where is the connection point and where is the area that they want to build on. This is giving you quite a lot of work on one hand, because you have to find the spot and the connection point, which is sometimes not that easy. In Hungary, it was not that easy because we have quite a limited number of connecting points where you have free capacities to connect your 20, 30 megawatts of capacities. But on the other hand, actually, it is giving you quite a big freedom of choosing your site, because it means that if you are, for example, an industrial site, or if you are even a power generation, which happened actually, you are a coal-based generator, and you know that you have few hectares of areas where you can build your photovoltaic plants, and you have already the connection point because your lignite plant is just connected there, this is giving you lots of price advantages. So that's a big advantage. If you don't make the restrictions, these areas can come into the system and they can give you good price. But let me elaborate one more, because I think there is one more side of the question, is that some countries, if you have a look at the example of Germany, they are actually applying this, that they don't have actually locational restriction, but they have some restriction in that sense that they are allowing the building up of these sites on a so-called brownfield areas. They don't allow to build the photovoltaic plants in an agricultural area, because they say that on the longer term, I would like to leave it for agricultural production. So where you can build your site is, okay, all the industrial facilities just by side of highways and railways and in such a systems, and in not utilized agricultural areas, but utilized when they are not allowing. And in that way, you have a certain restrictions because you are removing them away from agricultural areas, but in the rest of the areas, they are free to select their site. And of course, what we see here is that more restrictions you make, the price can go up significantly. So more restrictions you make on the site specification, for example, in case you are only allowing them on industrial sites, then it would mean that you are really reducing the available land site, and then it might increase the cost in the auction. Okay, I don't know if I answered what you were saying.
Oh, thanks. That was actually read my mind, because the issue of land allocation and potential competition with agricultural lands is also something we're just starting to have a dialogue on, not necessarily on the policy agenda yet, but something that the NGOs, environmental NGOs, have been alerting about in the long run, and whether or not the regulation should distinguish and differentiate based upon what land you're using. because it's really, we, you know, we're seeing tens and eventually hundreds of megawatts going after highly productive arable land, you know, flat for fields, cultivation, etc. So thanks for sharing that experience. That's good to know.
And actually, if you start to think of that, I think Hungary will be a good example in 1 or 2 years' time, because actually what happened here in that, that in the two first auctions, there was no land restriction. So any type, even agricultural land was available to use. And now the ministry said that they are planning to change this. So probably in the next auction round, they might put some restriction to avoid that they really highly utilize and with a very quality agricultural land they want to exclude at least. So they would allow the brownfield and maybe some less quality agricultural land still can go in. And then we can see, and then it will be a good indication whether it would have an impact on the prices. So Hungary would be a good case study for that in 1 or 2 years' time. And I think it's good to start to think of that quite early at the beginning, because once you made the installation there, it's true that it's actually power, a photovoltaic farm is not destroying actually your land in that sense, that if you would just demolish the whole plant, you can start it again, but that's already capital cost is gone. So it's good to plan in advance that once you are building up a photovoltaic plant, which has a lifetime of 10 years, or sorry, 20 years at least, probably it would be there even on a longer period, because already the connection point is there, you have the land designed for that. So probably once you design it for there, it might not just stay there for 20 years, but probably for a longer period. And in that case, it's already good to bring this thinking of, okay, over the long term, would I like to see that PV stations would occupy the best arable land? Probably not. So it's good to give some directions for the investors that if they can, please avoid those areas which are very fertile agricultural land and don't start to plan your big sized capacities. Okay.
Yes, thank you. So, some other questions from participants?
Meanwhile, you start to think, I might share some additional experience in the Hungarian situation, okay? And then if you have questions, just raise your hand or just tell me loudly and then I will try to answer those. So it's quite a dense slide what you see on the screen now. And what I would like to tell you that there is one interesting fact, there are quite many interesting facts in the Hungarian auction. And that's a very good question, that the difference between the €6 price, which happened 1 year ago, and the 4.7 point price, which we had this year. What is the reason to have this 21% reduction in price only in 1 year? And that's a good question, because I'm pretty sure the technology is not learning that quickly. So the investment cost difference is not 20%. It might have reduced, maybe 2-4% reduction in 1 year, you can imagine in the photovoltaic technology. And then it's a good question, what is the reason to have this 20% reduction? And I think there are three factors here. The first factor is that, and I wrote it on the slide, that actually we changed from a €20 megawatt maximum capacity limit to a €40 megawatt. So 20 megawatt was the capacity maximum in the first auction, and it was 40 megawatt in the second auction, which meant that we doubled the size. And then what we saw actually that even more investors. So at the first auction, we had quite a nice level of competition above 1.5. So more than 50% oversubscription of the technologies. In the second auction, it was more than 4 times. I think it even reached the 5 times more auctioners came to the auction than the available capacity was, which meant that they really gave good prices. And the impact probably was quite important, that 40 megawatt is quite a sizable capacity. And I think that's another interesting part which you have to consider when you are planning for auctioning, whether you are putting a ceiling cap and where do you put it. And then we see a very diverse experience in Europe. For example, in Germany, for photovoltaic, the cap, maximum capacity is 10 megawatts, so it's much below the ambient. With a quite significant limit. In Hungary, we applied the 20 and now it's 40. In some other countries, like in the case of the Spanish and the Portuguese, actually, if they put it was very high, but actually I don't think that they apply. So there are sites for 250 megawatts in the Portuguese case. So very sizable capacity. And then this is a contributing factor. You are increasing the size. You are getting probably better prices for two reasons. The first reason is that your auction is more attractive because developers, they don't really like 1 or 2 megawatt size. It's too small for them. Second issue, the higher the size, you have this economy of scale. They can really reduce the cost of it because building another will have a more economic if we are doing that. So probably this is there. But again, why you might start to think we have to put some certain capacity limit is that countries like Armenia, which is probably you have a smaller system than Hungary. So even a 40 megawatt PV system is quite sizable in that sense that just imagine a situation if that site is there somewhere in a nice situation and then there is a sudden change in the weather in 1 hour or 2 hours, you have a very cloudy situation over that location. You can imagine it would make a very significant drop in your production level, and then you have to balance it. In a country like Armenia, I think it's at the moment it would be easy because with hydro-based generation or gas-based generation, you can do that. But just imagine what happens in Hungary in that time when we have a lot of nuclear production, lots of photovoltaic with high size plant. This volatility in the production would be there, and we don't have hydro. We don't have cheap hydro for that. At the moment, we are balancing it with gas-based generation. If I remember well, actually, your balancing unit is a gas fire. I'm not 100% sure, but I think that's the situation, which can be quite costly. So that's why you might want to put a limit as well because of the integration reason. And the other thing is that 40 megawatt site is quite a sizable one. So if you start to imagine that you have this amount of capacities on one location, and if it's agricultural area, you might start to think that it might not be the best case. Actually, in the case of Spain and Portugal, the situation is much easier. If you have ever been there or if you have seen the situation, they have really areas which are not suitable for agricultural areas. So in those locations, you can imagine bigger sized capacities can be installed without problem, and they have quite sizable electricity system. I mean, probably Spain has 4 or 5 times bigger system than Hungary. So that's another important consideration. So that was one additional reason why this why you went down from the 6.8 euro cents to 4.7. And then maybe just one more reason, and if you have further question, I will answer that. Any auctions we have seen in we had case studies on 10 auctions. We see this learning effect in the auction as well, because this is quite true that the same developers, if this is the first auction in your country, they might be a bit hesitant to give the best prices. And as the auctions going further and further, you have the second, the third, and the fourth, they see it's a reliable auction, it is coming as it was planned, they are willing more and more to tell their true reserve prices, and then it would reduce the prices further. We saw it in the Hungarian auction, we saw it in the German auction, we saw it in the Danish one and the Dutch one, and that's why you can be sure that if you are doing your auctions regularly, every year at least once. In Hungary, we are planning twice a year. In Germany, 4 times a year. Then investors will be more and more willing to come to your system because they would see that's a reliable option. They would come and the price would go down. I'm sorry, you might have a question.
I just wanted to address your question. In Armenia, we first started with a feed-in tariff for small systems of 1 megawatt and 5 megawatt. And then the first auction was for 55 megawatts and the price was $4.10. That was the deal was. Now there are a couple of pending auctions for 20, 30 megawatt. And we're hoping it has to be around that price or lower. Thank you.
Maybe I was a bit too quick in explaining it that, you know, the capacity limit here is because we did not do the auction for the 40 megawatt. But actually this capacity limit is for one installation. So this means that at one connection point, you can connect a maximum of 40 megawatt. But actually at the end, what we have reached it is that we had it was a bit more than 100, so 150 megawatt, which was already installed in the, which was announced as winner in the second round. So in the first one, we had a bit less, and in the second one, we increased the total capacity, but what the limit is there, the limit is for the single installation at one connection point. It cannot be higher than 40 megawatt, which was previously 20. And then maybe one more information on that one is that we had a very specific auction design where we did not put actually the capacity as the auction item, but actually we were putting the megawatt hours actually. So they were bidding for megawatt hours, not for megawatts, because it's quite different among the technologies. So because geothermal, biomass, photovoltaic can be in. It was not megawatt based, but megawatt hour of produced renewable electricity. I don't know what was the situation in Armenia. Did you do it for megawatt and technology specific, or did you do it more neutral? So was it only for photovoltaic technology, or you opened it up for other things?
It was actually one of those cases like you described in Albania. There was a very particular selected land slot, okay, a capacity, and an auction for the kilowatt hour price.
Actually, the price you mentioned is quite good, I think. I mean, $4.1,
and this was 3 years ago. So they're still in the starting stages of construction. But I'm actually interested in what I learned right now is it's actually a much better thing to not auction the capacity, but the actual output, the power generation, because that way you give them liberty and technology.
Yep.
And well, levelized energy cost of generation certainly is a good argument. And they try to propose the best, most efficient technology to get the cheapest specified, you know, unit cost of electricity generation. But if you give them the choice for any renewables, then, you know, that's good diversification of the portfolio. Thank you.
Yes, actually, this was the reasoning of Directorate General Competition. Is that once you are very specific in the technology, you are not allowing the investors to consider other suitable technologies. And that was the main argument from the European Commission that, okay, let's try to move for this more technology, multi-technology, or even technology-neutral auction, because in that way, you would have an information that, okay, what is the price level of the various capacities? And actually what happened is that in Europe, many countries started to do not the technology-neutral auction, but the multi-technology auctions. And it's a quite interesting example, because what happened that Germany already started, and I think Netherlands and Denmark is quite advanced as well with this, that they did not do the full opening, but what they did is that they opened the auctions together for the wind and photovoltaic. So a mixed auction, because they were uncertain a bit that which technology is cheaper. Now, if you have a look at the prices in Europe in certain countries, you really saw it that they were quite at a similar level, levelized cost-wise. And then they were curious that who would come as a winner. And that was an interesting case because there were auctions where both technologies came into the picture. So there were winners from the wind and from the photovoltaic. And there were auctions which were rather biased toward one or the other. But I think my impression is that wind and photovoltaic, if you have good locations for wind technologies, you have good location for the solar, they are quite competitive, and it's good to open this competition for them. The other lesson was that some countries like Poland and Hungary, we really did the opening for the other technologies, and in Hungary we had few bits from other technologies. So 99% of the bits were from PV, but we had one waste burning facility because that was alone. There was one geothermal, and I think there was one biomass in one of the rounds, but they were far, far not competitive. So the lesson from that one that at the moment, biomass, if you want to have biomass-based generation in the system, probably you wouldn't compete them together with the photovoltaic. If you really want them, you might have to have a separate option. Wind and photovoltaic at the moment could come together. And I think it was in Spain when sometimes it was the wind technology, sometimes it was the PV, depending on the design. So they could be competing with each other. But for geothermal and biomass, they are not in that good shape yet, price-wise, that they would compete in. But you can still open the competition, and you would see that where are they and what is the information available for the competitors. That's why it's an important question when I showed you that slide, and I just jumped there, that how many items you have to think of when you are designing auctions. There are quite many of them. And then this is that actually what you are auctioning has quite an important impact. As you mentioned, whether it's megawatt or it's megawatt hour, it matters as well. I think I have 10 minutes more. So if you have questions, just please come up with
yes, a few more questions.
Yes, yes, we got a couple of questions in the chat. And I may ask Nunes Akanyan to read them, and then some other questions maybe as well. Or I may read. So Nunes Akanyan asked first about the land degradation issue.
Okay.
So you mentioned it already, so if you could also tell about the decommissioning on photovoltaic waste. And the other question he asks, social acceptance of photovoltaic installments in Hungary. So are there any issues, or are they considered while shaping the policy, taking into account planned and continuous photovoltaic installments?
Very good questions again. So I'm just writing it down that you were asking. And the second is decommissioning. Let me start with the decommissioning. It's a very interesting question because, more and more people and everyone has to think of this circular economy issue. That once you are producing a technology, either photovoltaic or wind generation, it's a green production, of course. But once they have to be decommissioned, it will be a waste as well. So that's a very, very serious issue with both of the cases. And this is, I don't think that too many countries have good experience and a good practice with this. Actually, what Hungary did was that at the very beginning of the process, Hungary started to introduce a charge, actually, on the photovoltaic development. So based on the size of the plant, so based on the square meter of photovoltaic panels which was installed in a certain capacity, they are putting a certain charge, which is going to a separated, actually it goes to the state budget, but it's collected and it's accumulated over time because that money will be available for the decommission part of it. So that's already the signal that there will be some money left in the central budget. But once these plants will be decommissioned, and there is money set aside for decommissioning. I'm not 100% whether the price level which we were setting will be sufficient for that. But I think that's a that's a good signal to signal for the producers. Look, you have to think of this way, because we know that in the photovoltaic panels there are some nasty materials as well, which you cannot just throw away, but you have to collect these heavy metals in the panels as well. Actually, similar issue raises with the windmills as well, because these blades as well, they are made of material which cannot be very easily recycled. So that was the approach, but I would say that we are far from a perfect solution, and we are far from telling the stories on the good practices, because actually by heart, I cannot really tell good practices. I just saw a few examples of the bad practices, which was done, I think it was a US example, when the windmills were decommissioned actually. And that was what they did, is that the concrete part was okay, that one you can use for many purposes, but the blade itself was just not recycled at all. It was just digged somewhere, and that's not a good practice, I agree with you. And I think you should start to think of this, introducing these charges for the recycling, and you might start at low and you might gain experience of where should be the level of this charging. The second question is even more interesting, I think, because this acceptance issue is very important in some countries. And then you were asking this in relation to the photovoltaic technology, but I would say that in Europe, it's more of a concern with the wind, onshore wind-based generation. So all these windmills which are placed on land and not onshore. And what is the issue here? The issue here, and it's coming in Germany, in the Netherlands, and other countries, is that many people start to feel that wind-based generation is annoying for them. I mean, if it's too close to your household, then it's not good. It is deteriorating your life style. It's deteriorating your life quality. It's deteriorating the value of your house. So that's not a good thing to be living very close to the windmill. So that's why many countries in Europe, they introduce a so-called distance rule, which can be expressed in 1 or 2 kilometers, that they don't allow construction of these sites very close to habitat area. I think that's a good solution, that you move them away from the habitat area. The problem comes in Germany and in the Netherlands, that it's very difficult to find sites. Sites. And actually, in Hungary, if the distance rule is this, 1 or 2 or 3 kilometers, you would have available sites. But in Hungary, the government decided to go for a 10-kilometer, which I think it's too excessive. It's too much. With that one, they actually prohibited building windmills. However, if it's further than 3 or 4 kilometers, I don't think that it has any impact on you. Still, there are these not in my backyard effect. So many people think that the further away they are, the better it is. So you might start to think as well in your country, probably you have a distance rule here. If not, then you would consider sooner or later that you are not allowing windmills to be very close to your houses. On the other hand, with the photovoltaic generation, we did not hear too much problem from that part, actually, that you don't like this in your neighborhood, because actually a power plant based on photovoltaic is not making noise. It's not that destroying any aesthetic feeling. So at the moment, we do not have problems. The problem could come, and that we have already talked a bit, that when these become very sizable, it can be a problem that you don't really want to see these photovoltaic plants over a good agricultural areas that you might introduce into your planning system, that you might want to avoid this type of situation, and you might avoid some tools to avoid this installation on a very fertile agricultural areas. And there are tools I already mentioned to you that you can introduce in your auction system. A certain, either you penalize and you don't allow this certain agricultural areas, where you put a penalty payment if they would like to build it there. And in that way, you are moving them away from this good agricultural areas. I hope I answered this question. And I know I see the chat, and then if you have further questions, just please let me know. And I will try to.
Thank you. So there was another question, I guess.
Mm-hmm. Please. Which one do you think?
It was from Neste Andreasian.
Yes. Thank you for your presentation. I would like.
Okay. I see this is the net metering question, the first one. Or do you have another one?
No, I have another one.
Okay, please.
Yes, I would like to know your experience in Hungary regarding establishing associations and involving them in the process of, let's say, developing the renewable energy market and maybe forming some cooperatives. The experience in Hungary.
Okay, very nice question again, I think. Because that's an approach in many countries in Europe, right? That they would like to see a bigger or deeper involvement of the local communities into this process. Because actually, what is the one of the keywords which we always tell in renewable generation, that no, this is a generation type where you can participate. So that can be a very nice political message. That, look, if you are a small cooperative, a small joint association of people in the neighborhood, you can be the one who built your own renewable generation, and it's partly true. And in many systems, you are starting to give advantage to these association and cooperatives. What is the way in it? So. The most advanced countries in that sense are the Netherlands and Germany, and Denmark has some experience as well, where they have really this cooperative. Sometimes these are people who join in a certain location, sometimes it's a local authority who is collecting people and then they do their own generation system. Sometimes it's just individuals who are building together something, either a windmill or photovoltaic mill in the neighborhood. And they could come if you are allowing them. And actually it's a good example of what we do in Hungary, because actually the other information which I had on the slide, that actually we made two types of auction. The first type was for smaller reactors, so between 0.3 megawatt up to 1 megawatt. And there are the bigger reactors above 1 megawatt. Maybe you can set the limits differently, but you can see that there are differences in prices. So if you are announcing an auction where you don't put a, you don't separate the smaller reactors and the larger reactor, what we see from the numbers is that smaller reactors will not be able to compete with the big size. So a 0.3 megawatt capacity, we are not able to do pricing which 5 megawatt or a 20 megawatt producer can offer. That's why it's important to make this distinction for the cooperatives and the local people, that who can they be involved in the process. And some countries went for this solution that you go for the small category and then you have higher chances as the cooperative to go for that one. However, we see that still it can be taken by rather private companies than the cooperative itself. We saw another solution in this type in Germany, where in certain auctions, they made a specific basket, let's call it basket, in a given auction, where they said that if it's coming from a cooperative, we make a separate competition for them, because then we make a quota of, let's do 20% or 10% of the total auctioned quantity, we go for this cooperative. And I think it can be done in the right way. There was a bad experience actually in Germany, because the way they defined the cooperatives was that there has to be at least two persons from the neighborhood, something like this, with a share of X percent in the project. And it was very easy to overcome this. And then it was big companies who were taking on board one or two investors from a given location, and by that they gain some price competitiveness over the others, and they won this capacity. And Germany finished with that one. So they made, I think, two rounds like this. And at the end, they said that this is not the right solution. And they are still thinking that what should be the good solution for cooperatives and local people, because that's what they emphasize. And we are even willing to pay a bit more for these generators if they, if really the local people and the local capital is involved, because that in that way, people will feel that this renewable is not just for the big companies, but it's for their own use. And I think it's an important message, and it's good to emphasize that it can have a very positive effect on the system over the longer term. If people would feel that, okay, this is a system where I can participate, it is my share, so they would like this system. Give another negative example of it was the Czech Republic, when they did 2 gigawatts of installation in 2010 and 11. It was a really big jump in the capacity. They made it quite early, and it had an impact that the price impact was between 7% and 10%. And it was rather a higher size capacities. So it was not the small investors, but rather bigger sized energy companies who did these investments. And at the end, what happened, that what did the consumer saw? They saw that, okay, what happened? My bill increased 7% to 10%. I don't really like that one. The second issue was that who were the winner in this? They were big corporations, not the local people, not the local capital. And then they started not to like the system. And actually what happened in the Czech Republic, that in the next 8 years, they did not even allow building any new power plant in photovoltaic generation. They were going for other technologies, but in photovoltaic, we had a sudden stop, and then for 8 years they said that we had experienced it and we don't like to repeat it. No, I think they can consider that they, with the 1/4 of the money what they have paid for that at that time, they can have even higher installation in their neighborhood. So they might have a new installation coming in, but that 8 year was very painful for the others. So it's good to avoid this. And if the prices that you make these corporations and other local communities a bit more involved in the process, even paying a bit more for their production than the big players would pay, I think that's not a not a bad strategy for the country itself.
Thank you.
Thank you very much. So do we have any short question now before we finish, maybe?
Maybe I can answer this first question, which was asked by, because I might not have answered it, what is happening with the surplus generation, which
okay.
is
okay. Sure.
If there was a surplus in this net metering scheme, there was a calculated price, which was something like 1/3 of the total payment, which usually household pay. So they pay, if they paid at that time, €0.15 bill, but that's the total, including all the taxes. There was a 3-4 cents payment for the injected electricity. So rather low level, but they paid for them. And actually it was quite a lot of suffering for the regulator, because at the beginning, it was a difficult situation with the finance ministry, because the finance ministry intervened in this situation, because they said that if this scheme is generating income for the household, that's an income which has to be taxed. So there was a tax issue in it, and then it took 1 year for us to resolve it that, there might be a tax issue here, but we shouldn't make these households to become a company just for that one. So there was at the end an agreement between the finance ministry and the Ministry of Energy to solve the issue, and then they made a simplified scheme for that. But actually there was a certain payment to the same bill of the household, and that was the solution. But actually, you know, with the experience which the installers gained, actually in most of the cases they managed to have installation with rather zero bill, so there was no, on the net part, there was no payment. Rather, they started to increase the consumption. That was the impact, because it was for free. these people start to have buy electric cars or other electric appliances. At the end, they realize that they have to so high energy consumption that they cannot produce sufficiently their photovoltaic installation. So thank you very much for the questions. If you may allow me, I think I might leave if I answer most of the questions.
Thank you very much.
Thank you very much. Can anybody, can we have the recording and the slides at some point?
Yeah, well, I'll share the recording and if Laszlo may send the slides by email.
I will send you the slides.
Thank you very much.
Thank you very much.
Okay. Thanks a lot.
So let me thank you all for participating in today's event, and we will have a final discussion with Armenian experts in a few days. And then we'll publish a paper summarizing this part of the project. So thank you very much indeed. And have a nice day.
Same to you. And thank you very much for the invitation. Let's hope that I have to answer some of your questions. Thanks a lot. Bye.
Thank you.
Bye.
Bye-bye.
Bye.